Welcome to my channel, Interesting Engineering.
Today, in our video, we are going to discuss about ballistic galvanometer. This is the second instrument that we are discussing in our subject, electrical measurement. So, what's this instrument? This is an instrument meant for measuring the amount of charge flowing through the circuit. So, this is the major difference between a D'Arsonval galvanometer and a ballistic galvanometer. This is a more sensitive as well as a integrating type of instrument. Why this is integrating is, it calculates the amount of charge over a certain duration of time period. That's why it is called as an integrating instrument. So let's see about its difference in constructional part. So with regarding its construction, it's just similar to D'Arsonval galvanometer. The major difference lies only in the moving coil arrangement. So when we look at the diagram of a ballistic galvanometer, it's somewhat similar to that of a D'Arsonval galvanometer. Just look here. As usual to the D'Arsonval galvanometer, here we have an iron core at the center which is surrounded by number of turns of copper wire, and this arrangement is placed in between the pole pieces of magnet, and this is suspended at the top by means of phosphor bronze wire, and at the bottom it's suspended by means of a spring arrangement. It's somewhat similar to the D'Arsonval galvanometer. Here we have a mirror arrangement which is meant for measuring the deflection of coil through a lamp and scale arrangement. So the lamp provides the, here at one end we have a lamp that provides light source to the mirror, and by the movement of moving coil there will be the movement of mirror also, due to which the light source from the lamp will be arrived at a different time period at the scale arrangement provided at the other end. So the major difference in its constructional part lies here only in the moving system. That is, the moving system will have a high moment of inertia, due to which there will be a large amount of oscillation in this ballistic galvanometer. So that's the major difference between the D'Arsonval galvanometer and the ballistic galvanometer. So going back to the previous slide, let's see in the previous slide. So here, when we look at this slide, I have given the difference. Please check over here. This is similar to a D'Arsonval galvanometer with a certain difference in its features. The moving coil will have a high moment of inertia which enables large time period of oscillation. It has exceptionally minimal electromagnetic damping. These are the major differences between a D'Arsonval galvanometer and the ballistic galvanometer. So now we shall derive at the torque equation.
So this is our ballistic galvanometer. At the center we have an iron core surrounding which we have copper coil, and one end of the copper coil is connected with the charge that is to be applied, and the other end is connected with the other terminal through a spring arrangement, and this entire setup is placed in between the pole pieces of magnet. So this pole pieces of magnet provides a uniform radial magnetic field. So here when we pass charge current through the coil, there develops a magnetic field. So there is a presence of two magnetic fields here. The magnetic field due to the current flowing into the circuit, and the magnetic field developed by the pole pieces of magnet. So here, due to the interaction of these two magnetic fields, there develops torque. This torque deflects the coil. So when they due to the application of current over here, the coils the coil surrounding the core starts deflecting. It starts rotating. Okay, so due to this rotation, here we have slight movement of this mirror also. It's because the mirror is directly connected with the coil. So when the coil rotates, this mirror will also changes its position. So here we have a lamp and scale arrangement. So this is a lamp arrangement. So when the light falls into the mirror, it gets reflected back and falls over the scale provided over here. So when the mirror deflects, there will be change in the position of reflecting rays over the scale. So due to the interaction of magnetic field, the coil will be moving. So due to this movement of coil, mirror also rotates. So whenever light falls over the mirror, then it has to be reflected back to the scale. So due to the movement of mirror, there will be changes in the reflection obtained in the scale arrangement. So this reflection can be controlled, can be obtained by means of this spring arrangement here. So the spring will make whatever the rotation of this, whenever the coil rotates, it is balanced by the spring provided at the bottom. So this spring will be providing a restoring force. Restoring force on the movement that is encountered by this moving coil. So whenever this restoring force is balanced, whenever the movement of the coil is balanced by the restoring force, the coil will be in a steady position. So at that position, what is the position of mirror? At that position of mirror, we can even what the scale reading shows, it will be the measurement of charge entering into the circuit. Clear all of you? Due to the interaction of magnetic field, we can able to obtain the movement of coil. So that movement is being controlled by the spring arrangement provided at the bottom of the galvanometer. So this spring will produce a restoring force. Now we shall derive at the torque equation of a ballistic galvanometer. So this torque equation describes about the operation of the ballistic galvanometer. So due to the interaction of magnetic fields, there causes deflection, and that deflection is restored by means of spring. So when these two forces are balanced, the coil remains in a steady position, which is noted by means of the scale arrangement. So that's the operation. Now we shall derive at the torque equation. So before entering into the torque equation, let me describe about certain terms involved in the torque equation. So first term is the L, where L represents the length of the coil and B represents the breadth of the coil and A is nothing but area of the coil, which is equal to L into B. So this describes about the moving coil system. And due to the current entering into the moving coil, there occurs some sort of force in the coil, which is called the torque, and it is represented by tau, and that is equal to NAB into I, where N represents the number of turns of the coil, A is nothing but the area of coil, B is called the magnetic flux density, and I is nothing but the current flowing through the coil. So in the ballistic galvanometer, it's otherwise called an integrating type of instrument. So it measures the current flowing through the circuit for a duration of 0 to t. So we are going to integrate this equation. So tau integration of 0 to t tau dt is equal to NABI. This is also integrated within the limit of 0 to t. It's integrated for a duration of time period starting from 0 to t. Here the terms n, a, b are all constants. So taking it outside, we can write it as n, a, b integral 0 to t I dt. So integration of I dt is nothing but integration of current over a time period, is we can call it as a charge, and it is represented by Q. So integration of tau for a duration of time period 0 to t will be equal to n a b q, where n is the number of turns of coil, a is nothing but the area of coil, b is the magnetic flux density, and q represents the charge flowing through the coil. So let's go back to the movement. Here we have a angular movement. So this angular movement, due to the angular movement, we have angular momentum, and angular velocity is represented by omega, and I is nothing but the moment of inertia. Omega is angular velocity. So we can represent it as angular momentum can represent the moment of coil by means of angular momentum, and that is equal to I omega. So here we have angular momentum of the developed in the coil. So in this coil arrangement, we have the movement of coil in a angular movement. So due to this angular movement of the coil, there develops a momentum, and that is represented by I omega, where I is nothing but moment of inertia and omega is nothing but the angular velocity. So this angular momentum is due to the force acting on the coil. So angular momentum is due to the force acting on the coil. So we can equate these two. So I omega is equal to NABQ. So this on equating the force acting on the coil, due to the force acting on the coil, there develops deflection of the coil, which creates angular momentum. So we are equating it as I omega equal to NABQ. So due to the movement of coil, when the coil deflects, there creates kinetic energy. And this kinetic energy is being restored in the spring by means of potential energy. So whatever the kinetic energy developed in the coil, when it is being completely stored in the spring arrangement, then the coil remains in a steady position, which can be measured by means of the scale arrangement. So when these two becomes equal, we can have a deflection, we can able to measure. So first let's see what is the kinetic energy of the system. Kinetic energy of coil is equal to, we can have this as 1 by 2 I omega square, and the potential energy of the coil is equal to 1 by 2 C theta square. So kinetic energy is due to the movement, deflection of the coil, and it is represented as 1 by 2 I omega square, where I is nothing but moment of inertia and omega is nothing but the angular velocity. And potential energy, whatever the kinetic energy being developed in the coil, is being restored in the spring in terms of potential energy, and it is represented as 1 by 2 C theta square, where C is nothing but the spring stiffness and theta is nothing but the deflection of the coil. So when these two are balanced, the system remains in a steady position. So we equate these two equations. So 1 by 2 I omega square equal to 1 by 2 C theta square. So this is represented as, so since we have 1 by 2 on both sides, we cancel these 1 by 2. So we have it as I omega square equal to C theta square. So this is our first equation. Let's have it as a first equation. Then comes the periodic oscillation of coil. So this is, in this ballistic galvanometer, due to the higher moment of inertia in this coil, due to the high moment of inertia in this coil, there occurs the movement of the coil resulting in kinetic energy. So this will have a low undamped oscillations. So we can have a undamped oscillation here. So that oscillation time period can be represented as T is equal to 2 pi into root of I by C, where T is nothing but the time period of oscillation, I is the moment of inertia, and C is nothing but the spring stiffness. So to eliminate this square root, I am squaring on both sides, so it becomes T square equal to 4 pi square into I by C. So we need the value of I, so I am taking all other terms to the other side, so it becomes T square C by 4 pi square will be equal to I. So this is our second equation. Now let's multiply the equation 1 with the equation 2. So it will be I square omega square is equal to C square T square theta square by 4 pi square. So when we check this equation, we have square terms on both sides of the equation. So on taking square root, we have it as I omega equal to C T theta by 2 pi. So we have this as C T theta by 2 pi. Already we have seen I omega is equal to NABQ. So I am going to substitute this NABQ here. So NABQ is equal to C theta by 2 pi. So this charge, we need to calculate the amount of charge. So I am going to bring all these terms to the other side. So Q is equal to C theta by 2 pi into NAB. So when we look at this equation, the terms C, T, 2 pi, N, A and B, these are all constant values. So I am going to replace this by a single constant K. So Q is equal to K into theta, where Q is nothing but the amount of charge flowing in the circuit, K is nothing but the constant, and theta is the deflection of the coil. So when we look at this equation, the amount of charge flowing through the circuit will be directly proportional to the deflection of the coil. So the amount of charge in a galvanometer can be measured by means of the deflection of coil. So this is about the working of ballistic galvanometer. So far we have discussed about what is a ballistic galvanometer and how does it operate. So a ballistic galvanometer is an instrument meant for measuring the charge flowing through the circuit, and it measures the amount of charge by means of deflection of the moving system. So that deflection is achieved by means of interactions of magnetic field. So here, as per our discussion, we have derived the torque equation and we derived the expression for Q as Q proportional to theta, and here we can write it as Q is equal to K into theta. So this is the expression for ballistic galvanometer. So here Q is the amount of charge in the circuit and it is equal to the deflection of the moving system, and here we have a constant K. So we need to set a value for K before using this instrument. So to determine the value of the constant K is called the calibration. So let's discuss about calibration. So calibration is nothing but standardizing any instrument. Before making use of any instrument for our measurement purpose, we need to calibrate any instrument. So this calibration, the calibration of ballistic galvanometer, can be done by means of two methods. One is the capacitor method and the other one is the mutual inductance method. So in the capacitor method, first let's discuss about the capacitor method. So here we make use of circuit like this. This is the capacitor C, and here we have a resistor, adjustable resistor, and a galvanometer over here, and this is connected to a switch arrangement. This is connected to a switch arrangement, and the entire unit is connected with a battery source. So as we all know, this capacitor is a energy storing element. So whatever the energy applied, whatever the potential applied over here, it is being stored using a capacitor, since it is a energy storing element. So this voltage source is controlled, is operated, is activated by means of a switch arrangement provided here, and this switch has two positions. When the switch is connected at position 1, the voltage from the voltage source enters into the capacitor, and there occurs charging of the capacitor. So when the switch is at position 1, the capacitor receives this potential, and there occurs charging of the capacitor. And now when the switch is placed at the position 2, there occurs the discharging of capacitor. So the discharging current of capacitor makes the galvanometer placed here to deflect. So during charging, it stores some sort of energy by means of voltage source here, and that stored energy will be discharged when the switch is at position 2. So during discharge, it makes the galvanometer to deflect. So that deflection is determined at a constant, at a deflection theta. So we can measure the galvanometer constant Kg by the expression theta by Q by theta 1, where Q is nothing but C into E divided by theta 1. This is the expression for measuring the galvanometer constant. So here Kg equal to Q by theta 1, and Q is nothing but Ce by theta 1. So C represents the capacitance value, E is nothing but the voltage source, and theta 1 is the deflection of the galvanometer. So by means of this system, we can able to calibrate, analyze the value, analyze the galvanometer constant. So by means of this method, we can able to calibrate a ballistic galvanometer. We also have another method called the mutual inductance method. As we all know, for a mutual inductance to work, we need two different coils, a primary coil and the secondary coil. So the any primary circuit will be provided with a voltage source, and at the secondary end we place a galvanometer. So when the first coil gets energized due to the mutual inductance principle, the second coil develops potential. That potential makes the galvanometer here to deflect, by means of which we can able to find out the value of galvanometer constant Kg. So these are the two methods available to calibrate a galvanometer. So calibration of a galvanometer is nothing but to determine the value of galvanometer constant. So this is about the ballistic galvanometer and its calibration methods. So regarding the application part, it is applied in various metering circuits and then laser displays. So these are all some of the application point of view of ballistic galvanometer. So as we have discussed earlier, a ballistic galvanometer is meant for measuring the charge flowing through the circuit. The major difference between a ballistic galvanometer and a D'Arsonval galvanometer is the arrangement, moving coil arrangement. So in the case of a ballistic galvanometer, the moving coil arrangement will have a large moment of inertia. So this is the expression for expression relating the charge with the deflection of moving system, that is nothing but Q proportional to theta, where Q is the amount of charge applied, charge that is to be measured in a galvanometer, and theta is nothing but the deflection of moving system. So based on these things, we can able to understand the ballistic galvanometer. So that's it about the ballistic galvanometer. In our next video, we shall discuss about PMMC instrument, permanent magnet moving coil instrument. So we shall see about PMMC instrument in our next video. So thanks for watching. Keep watching for more videos. Please subscribe and share.